Studios of KPFK Pacifica Radio in Los Angeles, this is Uprising and I'm Sonali Kolhatkar. It's Friday, July 10th, 2015. A year has passed since the brutal Israeli war on Gaza. We'll spend the hour today with intrepid journalist and writer Max Blumenthal. His new book is called The 51-Day War, Ruin and Resistance in Gaza. In a staged interview this week in Los Angeles, I spoke with Blumenthal about the disaster inflicted on Palestinians by Israel and what form survival and resistance is taking. That's coming up after the news. Joining us now to analyze today's headlines is Cristina Mislan. She's an assistant professor of journalism studies at the Missouri School of Journalism. Hi, Cristina.
Hello, Sonali.
Greek Prime Minister Alexis Tsipras stunned the world yesterday when he offered to make painful cuts in pensions and raise taxes in the latest proposal to creditors in exchange for an immediate cash infusion. Despite the fact that last week's definitive popular vote against austerity gave him the mandate to stand his ground, Tsipras seems to have caved into demands by Germany and the IMF in order to preserve Greek membership in the Eurozone. The Greek government has offered 12 to 13 billion euros in cuts in exchange for a 50 billion euros loan spread out over 3 years. The cuts are deeper than any offered before. The plan has yet to be ratified by the Greek parliament. Eurogroup finance ministers will consider it over the weekend, and if they accept it, it will be sent to the EU for approval. Well, Cristina, what happened? Did the Syriza party sell out?
Well, not only did the party give in to international pressure, but it also decided to go against the will of its own public. So recently, in a recent vote, Greek citizens voted no against a bailout. And so the party decided to go ahead and accept the bailout regardless. So in short, yes, some would consider that the party did sell out. But, you know, you mentioned some of the aspects of the proposal, and I'll mention just a couple more. So we see the proposal and we see a few measures that could be surprising if we remember that the party is supposed to be a left-wing coalition. So for instance, wage will be set on a downward trajectory according to The Guardian by 2019 to fill in stability of staff. And then you have, of course, privacy on any deal that countries make with these supranational organizations that exist like that, etc. And so I think what is kind of sad here, and definitely sad, is that the party really didn't take the opportunity to make a statement like maybe Argentina some years ago.
And then the Florida Supreme Court has ordered the state to redraw 8 congressional districts that appear to have been gerrymandered to benefit the Republican Party. According to a Washington Post report, the decision went quite far, quote, slamming political consultants and politicians for their secrecy, including deleted emails, and essentially arguing that the state legislature could no longer be trusted to draw its own districts. Lawmakers have been given 100 days to draw a new map. The ruling was made in a case brought by Florida Common Cause, as well as the Florida League of Women Voters, whose president Pamela Goodman told press that the decision, quote, sets a precedent for many states across the country who are dealing with gerrymandered districts. The decision could complicate matters for the GOP in the next election. Well, Cristina, we don't often think of how crucial congressional districts are to our political landscape. How important is this Florida decision?
It's extremely important. You know, some would say, critics would say, that gerrymandering actually has more negative effects than voter ID laws, for instance, and other regulations that Republicans are often implementing to keep large groups of people from voting. And so, as of in the New York Times, and this was in 2013, where obviously, gerrymandering wastes thousands of votes, right? So you have thousands of people who are voting in districts where they're packed into, and their votes still don't count because of the redistricting that Republicans often practice. And so what you see is a result of this disconnect between votes and representation. So the decision is crucial then to any conversation about voting rights in our so-called democracy. And gerrymandering has long been practiced, not only in the South, but in states like Virginia and Pennsylvania. So I finally see some action on this issue.
And finally, in an important follow-up to the Supreme Court's recent historic ruling legalizing same-sex marriage nationwide, Attorney General Loretta Lynch announced today that all married couples everywhere will now be eligible for federal benefits. Prior to the ruling, gay marriage was banned in at least 13 states, complicating the application of federal benefits. Lynch said in a statement, "I am proud to announce that the critical programs for veterans and elderly and disabled Americans, which previously could not give effect to the marriages of couples living in states that did not recognize those marriages, will now provide federal recognition for all marriages nationwide." Well, Cristina, this decision was expected, but still it makes tangible the practical benefits of legalizing marriage for all, right?
Definitely. No, we're finally reaching a point where same-sex marriage, at least legally, is being widely accepted. And so we finally joined about 14 other countries where same-sex marriage is legal. Now, at the same time, you know, we have to remember, as other civil rights issues have illustrated to us, it's not enough to only change the legal system. It takes much longer, and it's a hard battle to fight when to actually see culture change, right? And so it will be some time and real meaningful change in that area. And I also, again, want us to remember this is a victory that we should be celebrating, but we should also remember that the fight doesn't stop here. And many LGBTQ folks are starting that conversation where, now let's take it to the next step and let's talk about all the other issues that we have to fight against as well. For instance, like violence against our body.
Cristina, thanks as always for joining us. We'll talk to you again next week. Cristina Mislan is an assistant professor of journalism studies at the Missouri School of Journalism. This is Uprising. When we come back, we'll play an interview that I did on stage this week in Los Angeles with author Max Blumenthal on the one-year anniversary of the Israeli war on Gaza. We'll discuss his book, The 51-Day War, Ruin and Resistance in Gaza. Stay tuned. On July 8, 2014, Israel launched airstrikes on the Gaza Strip, followed by a ground invasion. The ensuing 51 days of war left more than 2,200 people dead, the majority of whom were Palestinian civilians, including over 500 children. More than 250,000 Palestinians were displaced. At least 10,000 homes were destroyed. And one of the journalists who witnessed the horror of the 2014 Gaza war was my guest, Max Blumenthal, an award-winning journalist and a best-selling author whose articles and video documentaries have appeared in the New York Times, the LA Times, the Daily Beast, the Nation. And he is also a former Puffin Foundation Writing Fellow for the Nation Institute. And his first book, Republican Gomorrah, Inside the Movement That Shattered the Party, became a New York Times bestseller when it was published in 2009. Then 2 years ago, he wrote Goliath, Life and Loathing in Greater Israel, for which he won the Cultural Freedom Award from the Lannan Literary Foundation last year. And when I interviewed Max about that book, he told me how Republican Gomorrah had become a bestseller in part because Terry Gross interviewed him about it on Fresh Air. But when Goliath came out, her producers explicitly rejected an interview. Criticism of Israel is not very popular at NPR or many other outlets, but that did not deter Max. He wrote a second book specifically focused on last year's war on Gaza, and it's called The 51-Day War, Ruin and Resistance in Gaza. And it's my pleasure to welcome you to Uprising to discuss it, Max Blumenthal. So
You begin your book by tracing the history of the latest Gaza war to the separation of Gaza by Israel and then the siege. When Israeli settlements were first expelled from Gaza, many people were hopeful that it meant the beginning of a two-state solution, but in fact it was an isolating of a people so that Israel could freely launch assaults. And that's sort of what's happened over the last few years. Can you expand on that?
Yeah, I mean, we are tracing the first anniversary of this war to today. It's the beginning of the 51-day war. It was not the 50-day war. If it was the 50-day war, we would be excising what happened 1 year ago today out of the narrative, which is that Israel launched airstrikes on military installations connected to Hamas in the Gaza Strip, which led to Hamas's first official retaliation and deployment of long-range rockets towards Jerusalem and Tel Aviv. So we have to keep that in mind, that this was a 51-day war. But when did this war actually start? The war on Palestine started in 1947, 1948, and it produced the Gaza Strip as we understand it today, which is as a warehouse for surplus humanity, something that's very anachronistic in human history. Where there's an unwanted population which has been ethnically cleansed, 750,000 indigenous people forced from their land, forced from their homes, and then ghettoized in this tiny strip of land. Now 72 to 80% of the population of the Gaza Strip are refugees, and they cannot return to their land, their property, inside what is now Israel, the self-proclaimed Jewish state, because they're not Jews. And so they're living in this walled-off ghetto. But from 1967 to about 2006, the Israeli military occupied the Gaza Strip from within. Ariel Sharon in the 1970s began establishing Jewish settlements inside the Gaza Strip. It was a failed project that he brought to an end in 2000, began bringing to an end in 2005. He formed a new party. Sharon was one of the founders of the right-wing Likud party, but he started a new party, Kadima, which brought together centrist elements, or those who were considered centrist in Israel, in order to create political establish political capital to get the vote he needed for what was known as the disengagement, the removal of the last 9,000 religious nationalist settlers. The army had to go in, remove these settlers. So liberals in Israel and in the U.S. Saw these images of these religious nationalist settlers being removed by the Israeli army, and they said Israel truly wants peace. It's removing settlers. In fact, the settlers were being moved into a settlement block in the West Bank. The Bush administration guaranteed that those major settlement blocks that separate Jerusalem, East Jerusalem, which was supposed to be the future capital of a Palestinian state, from the West Bank, would be placed in Israeli hands forever in the event of any peace agreement with the puppetized Palestinian Authority. And Arnon Sofer, who is the basically the advisor to Sharon, who convinced him to do the disengagement. Sofer in Hebrew means counter, and Arnon Sofer was called by his colleagues at Haifa University Arnon the Arab counter, because he was the advisor to successive Israeli governments on how to engineer a demographic majority of Jews. Sofer said, this has nothing to do with peace. It has nothing to do with peace at all. It's about getting more Jews under Israeli control. And I'll just read you a quote, which is Sofer predicting what would happen after the disengagement, which is in the introduction to my book. And this is a bloody prophecy that came true. He predicted that when 2.5 million people live in a closed-off Gaza, it's going to be a human catastrophe. This is the advisor to Sharon and Netanyahu. Those people will be even bigger animals than they are today with the aid of an insane fundamentalist Islam. The pressure at the border will be awful. It's going to be a terrible war. So if we want to remain alive, we will have to kill and kill and kill all day, every day. And that is precisely what the Israeli government and the Israeli military have done since this disengagement. When, with the settlers removed, Jewish citizens of the State of Israel removed from the Gaza Strip, the military has the freedom to act with unprecedented malevolence and violence against the civilian population of the Gaza Strip, using 2,000-pound fragmentation bombs and also implementing a panopticon-style system of occupation. In order to control a prison, you only need to control 1% of it, which is the perimeter. So Israel controls the, you know, the eastern side of the Gaza Strip, which is walls, electrified fences, and those walls, as you'll see on the first page of my book, are perched with remote-controlled machine guns. They control Gaza from the west with a naval cordon, and they control Gaza from the skies with drones, and from within with a network of collaborators that honeycombs every neighborhood in the Gaza Strip. Spies who are induced into spying. This is the most intensely surveilled piece of earth, possibly. And so this is the kind of system Israel put in place, along with, just to wrap up, this doctrine, a military doctrine called the Dahiya Doctrine, named after a neighborhood in South Beirut that the Israeli military completely destroyed in 2006 during the second invasion of Lebanon. After the war in Lebanon, which Israel basically lost to Hezbollah, the northern commander of the Israeli military, Gadi Eisenkot, who is now the chief of staff, who oversaw this attack on the Gaza Strip last summer, gave an interview to Yaron London, who's an Israeli pundit and journalist, and London summarized what Eisenkot told him. He said, from now on, everyone in Lebanon is Hassan Nasrallah, the spiritual leader of Hezbollah, and everyone in the Gaza Strip is Khaled Mashal, the head of Hamas's Politburo. In other words, there's no distinction between civilians and military. In fact, the Israeli military will from now on deliberately target the civilian population in order to demoralize it and force it, compel it to turn against the leadership and the armed resistance factions it supports. And of course, this is a failed doctrine. And each time it fails, the military intensifies the level of violence. And that's what we saw take place last summer, the most brutal attack since this doctrine of disproportionate warfare, disproportionate violence was put into place.
I want to get to the way in which Israel carried out that war, but let's trace the immediate point at which Israel had its reason to start last summer's war. On June 12th of last year, as you describe, a rogue Hamas cell in Hebron in the West Bank kidnapped three Israeli boys and killed them. And Israel realized these boys were killed, but deceived the world so that they could use the deaths of these three Israeli teens as a pretext for the new war. They put a gag order on journalists. They lied to the parents of the boys. And when all of this was playing out, it was up in the air. There was a question about whether Israel really knew whether they were dead or not. And you say in your book that you know that that's exactly what they did.
Yeah, and this has been well established. I mean, on June 12th, this is really where the war began. It began on June 12th, or this is the backdrop for the war. And it began not in the Gaza Strip, but in the occupied West Bank at an intersection where three Jewish Israeli teens were kidnapped. Now the background for this is the collapse of the peace process. The peace process collapses with Netanyahu and his right-wing coalition refusing the U.S. demand to release a batch of Palestinian prisoners in order to extend the peace talks. They go ahead, reject that, authorize new settlements. Martin Indyk, who is a former Israel lobbyist who used to work for AIPAC and is now leading the peace process, leading the negotiations for the U.S., packs up his luxury hotel in Jerusalem, goes home, and before leaving, blames Netanyahu and blames the Israeli government for the collapse of the peace process. The U.S. tacitly recognizes a Palestinian unity government, infuriating Netanyahu. And then this kidnapping happens. I think it happened because these two rogue operatives wanted to spur a prisoner release by other means. And that's so you kidnap some Jewish Israeli citizens and say, we want 1,000 prisoners out. The kidnapping immediately goes wrong. Within less than an hour, one of the boys in the car realizes these aren't Israelis picking us up, these are Palestinians. He phones the police. The police record the call, and they hear gunshots. They hear celebratory singing by the killers, Abu Aisha and Kowazme. And Kowazme's family is known for acting in contravention of Hamas orders to maintain ceasefires. And this was taking place during a ceasefire. They're known for going rogue. The Shin Bet and police investigators show up at the car. They find the burned car. They find blood in the car, DNA, bullets. They pretty much know that the teens are dead. Netanyahu knows that the teens are dead. What happens next is what led to this war. Netanyahu and the Israeli military and intelligence place a gag order on the entire media, forbidding any Israeli media or foreign or credentialed foreign media figure from reporting any details of the investigation, including that the teens are dead. Within 24 hours, the Israeli police had been to the home of those they suspected of the killing, Abu Aisha and Kowazme, and it turned out that the three boys were buried on the property of Marwan Kowazme in a shallow grave. So for 2 weeks, the Israeli public thinks that the boys are out there somewhere. The Israeli Foreign Ministry sends one of the boys' mothers to the UN Human Rights Council to plead for the world to help assist this investigation. And meanwhile, the Israeli military attacks the West Bank, enters the center of West Bank cities for the first time since the Second Intifada, arrests hundreds and hundreds of members of Hamas's political wing, or what's left of it in the West Bank. Hamas's leadership in the Gaza Strip is looking at this as an act of war. And then 2 weeks later, a team of volunteer Israeli hitchhikers, not the police or the military with all of its advanced mapping capacities and surveillance abilities in the West Bank, but volunteer hitchhikers find the boys in a shallow grave, and all hell breaks loose. All hell breaks loose because the Israeli public thought that, I'm supposed to straighten my mic, so, thought that these boys were alive, and now they're furious. Netanyahu pours gasoline on the flames of indignation and outrage. He stands before his cabinet and declares, "Vengeance for the blood of a small child, even Satan has not yet created." He calls explicitly for blood vengeance in comments that were relayed to the Jewish Israeli public. These comments were a direct quote from a poem by Chaim Bialik, the Hebrew poet who is writing about a 1908 pogrom in the town of Kishinev in the Pale of Settlement, where my family comes from, where Jews were totally dispossessed. And so he's sending the message that we are the victims of a pogrom by the new anti-Semites, the new Nazis. Within hours, mobs are taking over central Jerusalem, chanting death to Arabs, looking for Arab boys, Palestinian boys to kill.
And you use the word bloodlust to describe how Israelis seized upon these missing boys to demand revenge for their kidnapping. And of course, Israeli soldiers routinely harass, injure, arrest, and even kill Palestinian boys, but we don't hear almost anything about that. You even cite in your book where surveillance footage of Palestinian boys being killed was confiscated. And so right there, you see how some lives are worth far more than others.
Well, the surveillance footage that was taken of a group of boys being sniped at and basically killed in cold blood by an Israeli sniper at Betunia outside the Ofer military prison in May, which was, you know, relayed through international media to the world. They couldn't get the surveillance footage, so the Israeli military went and destroyed the CCTV of the store owner who recorded it. And then again, when Mohammed Abu Khuder, when he was killed, I actually, spent time with his family and got to meet some of the store owners. And once again, the Israeli police came to visit those store owners to basically take the footage that they had recorded to prevent them from giving it to the media, and it seemed like a cover-up attempt. Now, Mohammed Abu Khuder was the boy that was killed in revenge for these three Israeli teens. He was 15 years old, extremely skinny, but a really popular kid in the neighborhood of Shufat. Shufat is an occupied area of East Jerusalem that has one street running through it along with a light rail. And the light rail was designed to carry settlers from central Jerusalem to the settlements that lay around Shufat and are basically ghettoizing it. The main road is a thoroughfare for settlers and Palestinians, and these Palestinian homes line the road. So this is one of the areas where there's the most interaction between religious nationalists and fanatical settlers and Palestinians who are basically ghettoized. And Mohammed Abu Khuder was taken off, sitting on the ledge of his own home, taken by three fanatics who had been a part of these death to Arab rallies, incited by Netanyahu. They beat him into unconsciousness with a hammer, forced him to drink gasoline, and burned him alive. That was the blood vengeance that Netanyahu had asked for. The family has yet to receive any justice. They're still going to regular trials. They're barred from wearing images of their son in the trials. And his father, Hussein, who I interviewed, said, "We don't expect any justice at all. In fact, our cousin was beaten to death by Jewish fanatics, and they were all ruled insane and got off." Two friends of the family, a month later, were beaten by fanatics in central Jerusalem with bats and chains into a comatose state.
And Tariq Abu Khader,
the cousin who is an American citizen, was beaten brutally on camera by the Israeli police and was then imprisoned. And it took a massive lobbying campaign to get Betty Castor, who is his congresswoman in Tampa, to actually do anything to get the State Department to get him released. The U.S. government apparently was taking the Israeli government's word that Tariq Abu Khader, this kid who just simply wanted to go to a cousin's wedding and got caught up and beaten within inches of his life, was a terrorist. I mean, that was the assumption that the U.S., his own government, was operating under until they finally was released. So all of this chaos was setting the backdrop for the war. Shufat was on fire after Abu Khader's body was discovered. There were riots for days and days. The light rail station was destroyed. And on July 7th, 2014, when the Al-Qassam Brigades launched M-75 and J-88 rockets towards Jerusalem, these are the first brand of rockets produced in the Gaza Strip that could reach towards Jerusalem. They have very little explosive capacity, but they set off air raid sirens and do have a psychological effect. People of Shufat came out of their homes to watch the flare of the rockets and hear the air raid sirens. My colleague Allison Dagger from Mondo Ice was there, and one of the cousins of Mohammed Abu Khuder gripped her hand and pointed at a rocket and said, "That rocket's for Mohammed." These rockets were understood in Shufat as an act of resistance, as one of the only acts that could, one of the only means of recourse against the unlimited violence that had terrorized this community for years.
So Max, let's step back and talk about what your role was in Gaza. You arrived, I understand, after the war had already begun, and you began documenting the ground war. You had a chance to speak with survivors of the Israeli ground war. Tell us when you were there and what you did when you were there.
I finally arrived after getting credentialed by the Israeli government press office on August 13th or August 14th, and the ground invasion had ended by then. It had been over for about a week and a half, 2 weeks. 20% of the Gaza Strip lay in ruins, and these are the border areas, the areas in a really tough neighborhood because they're next to Israel. And 18,000 homes had already been destroyed. 100,000 people had been left homeless at that point. And with the first extended humanitarian ceasefire in effect, many of those people, the rubble people who'd been left homeless, were able to leave these UN shelters, which were actually UN schools that the Israeli military had been attacking. They'd been killing people, sleeping in the courtyards of schools. Scabies was spreading in these schools. They were just living in squalid conditions, and they decided, many of these people, that it was better to return to the rubble, return to the ruins of their homes, set up tents, sleep wherever they could, but at least be near their homes. And so as soon as I entered the Gaza Strip, which just in entering Gaza from Israel is a harrowing experience in itself, because you pass through what you described, Sholeh, as a great black gate riddled with bullets. I mean, that's what you pass through. And you look to your right, down a long series of concrete blast walls that separates Gaza from Israel, and you see the remote-controlled machine gun. You hear the drone over your head. You enter Beit Hanun, this northern city which has been wiped off the map. You see the destruction, and it's shocking. And as soon as I got there, I went to Shujaiya, which is the area east of Gaza City, where one of the fiercest battles of the war had raged, where the Israeli military got a bloody nose by young men who had basically come out of their houses to defend their neighborhood. And the entire place was gone. I mean, the image on the cover of my book is Shujaiya, and I just started immediately interviewing families and documenting the crimes and atrocities they had witnessed and these really remarkable stories of survival that they told me. So I had unfettered access to people in the rubble for about 5 or 6 days.
Was this where you found the map in Shujaiya?
Yeah.
This map that was discovered in a Palestinian home that you took back with you, and you, in a way, pieced together what the Israeli tactic for the ground war was, and this imaginary red line that, if crossed, simply meant you would be shot, but Palestinians didn't know what this red line was.
Well, let me set the backdrop for the significance of this map that I found in a empty ammunition box that had been left by Israeli soldiers in a home they occupied and destroyed. And it was that during the Battle of Shujaiya, an Israeli armored personnel carrier was destroyed. It was a Vietnam-era relic because the Israeli military had underestimated the capacity of the Al-Qassam brigades. The Al-Qassam brigades had developed new tactics and made many of their weapons were homemade, but they were increasingly advanced, and they found a way to take on the Israeli military on their own turf, mainly taking advantage of the sophisticated tunnel network that Al-Qassam Brigade's general commander, Mohammed Deif, had established to ambush the soldiers, then maintain engagement with them at less than 15 meters away, which neutralized the Israeli military's ability to provide air support and artillery support because they risked killing their own soldiers. The Israeli military was pinned down in Shujaiya, surrounded on all sides. And so they resolved to retreat immediately, place as many soldiers as they could in heavily armored personnel carriers, and then blanket the area with artillery shells. That's when this area was wiped off the map, when it was destroyed. The Israeli military remained in the neighborhood after that attack, in destroyed homes. They took up positions, many as snipers. And if you went into the homes, you would see names of the soldiers written on the walls. Their last names had been, you know, painted over for obvious reasons by the time I got there. And there were times next to their names, and that's who is on sniper duty. And you'd see sometimes holes punched in the walls, which, you know, US soldiers in Afghanistan call murder holes. They're trying to hold these areas and look for what they call terrorists, basically local armed groups. And so there was a ceasefire that was called in order to allow the International Red Cross to get into the neighborhood and retrieve the dead bodies, the dead who were killed in this Israeli ammunition barrage. The International Solidarity Movement, which is a group that brings international volunteers into Palestine to try to support Palestinian protests and so on, and work with local communities, went into the rubble with a young man named Salem Shamali, who they met on the way. He was looking for his family, and the Shamali family was one of the hardest hit. I mean, most of its members died during this war. Salem was 19 years old. He wasn't wearing any markings. He was wearing a green shirt. He wandered up a street into the rubble, and he was hit by a sniper. The International Solidarity Movement volunteer started filming this. He's hit again, and he calls out as he falls into the rubble, and then one more shot kills Salem. And this video is relayed to the world by the ISM. It was reported on by NBC News by Ayman Mohyeldin before he was mysteriously reassigned to allow Richard Engel to take over. And it was shocking footage. I mean, you're watching someone being executed by a sniper who's looking for his family. I met his family when I arrived, and they were living with relatives because their home had been destroyed. And I'd met other members of his family who had survived summary executions of their cousins. And so I met his parents, and his parents told me that they only found out Salem was killed when a relative emailed the video to them, and they knew it was him from the sound of his screams. They were devastated. Now, back in Shujaia, I found this map, and I didn't understand the significance of it at the time, but I kept it anyway, and it was a satellite map of the area from, and it's reproduced in my book, and it was produced for the Israeli military, but weirdly, the dating on the map was written American style, because in Israel, as in Europe, they put the day before the month, and here we put the month before the day. So I wondered if there was some kind of NSA collaboration that our satellite capacities had been used to provide them with this map. On the map, there was a bright red line or bright orange line drawn through a main, drawn through a street in the Gaza, in Shujaia, and it read Hardufim. I brought the map with me to the Russell Tribunal in September of last year, which is a tribunal that takes place in Brussels, and it was a people's tribunal on war crimes committed in the Gaza Strip. And I showed it to a friend, Eran Efrati, who was a Israeli combat soldier in the assault on the Gaza Strip in 2008-2009. He was a sergeant. And he told me, Hardufim means dead people, and it's what's called out on radio when we suffer casualties. But during Casled, it was called out by commanders in order to establish a free fire zone. Not only that, but Efrati had interviewed three active Israeli participants in the attack on Shujaia who told him that their commanders told them to set a red line. Anyone who crossed that red line could be killed. And Salem Shamali was one of those people who had crossed the red line. And so this map to me seemed to be a piece of evidence that the red line was not only a verbal command, but that it may have been actually established. And I didn't take the map with me, I photographed it because the possession of it is considered a national security crime in Israel, but I think it was important enough to reproduce in this book. And you know, being in Shujaia and all of, and in the rubble, it's simply being, you're inside a gigantic crime scene.
You spoke with Palestinian families whose houses were destroyed, whose houses were used as staging grounds for more destruction. You described how often these soldiers went and marked up the houses with the Star of David, with other graffiti, and the way in which they sort of tore through these neighborhoods, I think just revealed a lot about the attitude of Israeli soldiers and also what the basis, what the underpinning was for this ground war, that civilians are equivalent to the armed resistance, right?
Right. But with the, when you see the graffiti on the walls and homes that Israeli soldiers occupied, you can, you see the amount of contempt that they have for the occupants who are civilians, that they view the entire population as a nest of terrorists. We hear a lot about the price tag crimes that occur in East Jerusalem and in the West Bank, where Jewish Israeli settlers and vigilantes will attack Palestinian property, they'll deface churches, and they'll write, Muhammad is dead on mosques, Muhammad was a pedophile, they'll write all death to Arabs on, a Jewish Arab school in Jerusalem was burned last year. This stopped during the war. These attacks stopped during the war, primarily because price tag violence and vandalism was at an all-time low during the war, because the war provided Israeli society with a ventilation mechanism, with a catharsis for all the malevolent hatred it had built up against Palestinians, and it exploded in areas like Shujaia. And so I would find graffiti that read price tag inside homes that soldiers had occupied. Or I would find the logo for Beitar Jerusalem, which is the favorite football team of the far right in Israel. It was the Beitar ultras who were out in Jerusalem chanting death to Arabs after Netanyahu's call for blood vengeance. So this was a ventilation mechanism, and I think one of the most disgusting and upsetting images that I witnessed was in home after home after home, the symbol of the religion and the faith community that I'd been raised in. Stars of David were carved into staircases in Shujaiya. They were inscribed into furniture in Shujaiya. I went into a school in Hosea, which was one of the worst hit towns I've ever been in. And this is a school funded by USAID. It's your taxpayer money just basically being thrown away because, you know, we give, as one man in Hosea told me, we give Palestinians bread and we give the Israelis weapons to kill them with. And so this school had been vandalized heavily, and there were huge Jewish stars all over its walls inside. I reproduced a photo of that in this book. And in the principal's office, I found weapons, you know, because weapons had been stored in schools in Gaza. This weapon was a M72 light anti-tank weapon, or M72 Law. I read the markings on it, and it said, made in Phoenix, Arizona. By the Nammo Corporation, which is a Norwegian-owned arms corporation. It was a missile that's used, a shoulder-mounted rocket that is used to penetrate tank armor that was used against civilian homes in a farming town of about 13,000 people. And when you would go into some of these destroyed homes, the inside would be completely charred. I went inside the home of Asma al-Najjar. She had just gotten married to her husband, and everything was gone. It would just look like someone had set a fire inside their house, and she took the opportunity to take a rock and write small messages in her best English on the charred walls, one of which read, my small heart can't afford anymore. That's what these people were dealing with. Not only the violence, but just confronting face-to-face and intimate situations, soldiers who had been indoctrinated into a program of ethnic hatred.
Max, your book subtitle is Ruin and Resistance in Gaza, and we've talked a lot about the ruin. I want to talk about the resistance, and we referred a little bit earlier to the Al-Qassam Brigades, which is the armed military wing of Hamas. And in such situations of war, it's tempting to look at victims of war as simply victims, but Palestinians have been trying to fight back for a very long time. How are they fighting back against the most sophisticated, or one of the most sophisticated militaries in the world? How do they even begin to resist that?
Well, there are all sorts of different forms of resistance, and there is, you know, resistance that everyone in this room can take part in, which is the BDS movement, the Boycott, Divestment, and Sanctions movement. I'm glad to hear that, you know, there's a consensus in favor of that, because there's really no alternative at this point. People in the Gaza Strip don't have the opportunity to participate in BDS, nor in the West Bank. They are under siege, and the goods that they are forced to consume mostly are surplus Israeli-made goods. The occupied Palestine is the number two export market for the state of Israel. It's a literally captive market. So they resist in other ways. And in the Gaza Strip, they're unbowed, unlike in the West Bank, where the security services of Mahmoud Abbas use their weapons and their energy to arrest fellow Palestinians, to control fellow Palestinians on behalf of the occupier. It's the greatest gift ever given to the occupation and the entire project of Israeli apartheid. In the Gaza Strip, people refuse to participate in such a project, although they do live under the repressive authority of Hamas. They believe in armed resistance. They believe in resisting their occupier, just as people in Europe did during World War II, including Jews. Just as people in South Africa did under the direction of Nelson Mandela, just as Native Americans did It's a sort of a natural act. We associate the armed struggle of Palestinians, unfortunately, in the United States with the suicide bomber. And that has a lot to do with the lack of sophistication early on of the Al-Qassam brigades and these armed factions when they were in their kind of gestation period, in their embryonic phase. The first wave of suicide bombings was ordered by Yahya Ayash, who was one of the founders of the Al-Qassam brigades, after Baruch Goldstein's massacre in Hebron of 29 Palestinian worshippers. I think this was in 1994. Goldstein, by the way, comes from Brooklyn. At the time, the Al-Qassam brigades had very few weapons. In fact, they started with one gun, a 45 caliber Carl Gustav submachine gun that could only shoot about two bullets before the bullets started drooping from the barrel. So I talked about the, you know, Ayash was assassinated. His successor, Salah Shahada, was assassinated. His successor, Ahmed Jabari, was assassinated. And along comes Mohammed Deif, who was very close to Jabari. Deif has survived four assassination attempts. His last name means, it's not actually his last name, it's sort of his nickname. And I think in Arabic it means guest, because he's like the ultimate couch surfer. He can't stay in one location for a very long time before the Israelis will attempt to assassinate him. And they attempted and failed during the war. What Deif did after the disengagement was start to import more sophisticated weapons into the Gaza Strip. And with Adnan Al-Ghul, who was the Al-Qassam Brigade's weaponsmith, the Gaza Strip began producing its own rocket-propelled grenade launcher. They began producing their own mortars. They began producing long-range rockets. They produced their own drone, a weaponized drone, within this besieged area. And the point was to replicate the capacity of Hezbollah, which had kicked out the Israeli military from southern Lebanon and which defeated the Israeli military substantially in 2006. By being able to do this, by building up their military capacity, the tactic of suicide bombing and attacking soft targets in Israel, arbitrarily killing civilians, something that we are all repelled by, fell by the wayside. And that's why, after this war, if you look at the death toll, 72 Israeli citizens died. 67 of them were combat soldiers. The Israeli media was so desperate to show civilian suffering that the Times of Israel wrote an article about an owl in a kibbutz that had been wounded in a mortar strike. And they said the kibbutz owl was finally returned to the wild after, you know, an operation. So this is an example of, I think, of resistance, but it's also there's a generational factor. When the Israeli military operated inside the Gaza Strip, as they do in the West Bank, people were consistently humiliated. Their psychological fortitude was destroyed. And you have a generation growing up under siege, but without direct contact with these soldiers. They're not humiliated by these soldiers, and therefore they're not as afraid of them. This is the generation that was responsible for the Nahal Oz raid, which is probably one of the most famous acts of military bravado in Palestinian history, in which a team of Al-Qassam Brigade fighters entered Israeli territory through a tunnel, one of the first infiltrations from the Gaza Strip to Nahal Oz. In Nahal Oz, there was a military base and a kibbutz, meaning Israeli civilians were there. And this armed ambush team could have attacked the kibbutz if they had wanted to and killed dozens of people. Instead, they chose to burst into a military base, engaging Israeli soldiers in close quarter combat, killing every single one they engaged with, and leaving with only one casualty of their own. They recorded the entire event on a GoPro camera, which was relayed to the world on YouTube. Now imagine if you're a young Palestinian in the West Bank or a refugee camper in the diaspora, and the only video you've ever seen in which there's an interaction between Israeli soldiers and Palestinians is of those soldiers humiliating Palestinians. I mean, just this week we saw Israeli soldiers choking an elderly bread salesman in Jerusalem for not having a permit. and you finally see them achieving a battlefield victory. Just imagine what that does to you. It's restoring a level of dignity, and that's what the Al-Qassam Brigades aim to do through this war, and it's why that there is still consensus support for Al-Qassam from Mohammed Deif, who survived another assassination attempt after losing his wife and his kids. Bunker buster bombs were used to kill him, and he survived it. He's considered the Che Guevara of the Gaza Strip. Meanwhile, the political leadership of Hamas has probably never had, probably not had less support than at any time. So you have to see these two groups as distinct, the military wing of Al-Qassam and the political wing represented by Ismail Haniyeh and Khalid Mishal, who lives in Doha and lives a pretty lavish lifestyle. There's a real split there.
The pain that Palestinians go through on a daily basis, and then they go through on a periodic basis with these wars, is documented by you in your book. Others have documented it as well. And I want to ask you, Max, what went through your mind as you heard these stories of pain and despair from the survivors of Israel's brutal assault? In going through your book, it was the photographs of the children that haunted me the most. 500 Palestinian children among the 2,200 dead children. There's a picture in your book of a three-month-old, and that's the part that that's the hardest to reconcile. And any other country in the world who in 51 days massacred or caused the deaths of 500 children would be instantly labeled as genocidal.
Well, I want to be conscious of this, Mike. The G word, I don't know if I can declare what happened, if I can state with authority that what happened was genocide, according to the very conservative international legal definition of genocide. But we do know that 850 people were killed in their homes at night, 89% of whom were civilians. This is according to an Associated Press investigation. Entire families were killed in home at night. 89 families were erased from the civil registry of the Gaza Strip after this attack. So these families lost most of their members, if not all. And I can give you examples of how these families were killed. The Bach family, the patriarch of the home was the head of Gaza's police, so therefore he was considered a military target by the Israeli military. Lost over 20 members in one strike. A journalist who was on the scene told me that he found arms dangling from trees and fingers in the rubble. 25% of those who were killed in the Gaza Strip, according to B'Tselem, the Israeli human rights group, were killed at home at night. So these, you know, you're being killed at home at night by precision-guided Israeli missiles. That means that orders were given. According to B'Tselem, there was an open-fire policy in which orders were given to attack civilian homes with guided missiles. So what do we call that? And when you think of the 800,000 trees that the Israeli olive trees that the Israeli military and settlers have uprooted since 1967, think of the 89 family trees that were uprooted in the Gaza Strip. And what do you call that? There was one image I couldn't reproduce in my book, just because I didn't get permission in time. There's a version of it, but it's the image of five infants in death shrouds in an ice cream cooler. This is, to me, the defining image of the war, and it's the defining image of what the self-proclaimed Jewish state has become, what it's capable of, and why it needs to be stopped. These children were in an ice cream cooler at the Kuwaiti medical clinic in the center of Rafah. Now, the only reason they were there was because the main functioning medical clinic, the Al-Najjar Hospital, when all of the dead and wounded arrived after Israel attacked eastern Rafah on August 1st, The Israeli military called in its intention to bomb that hospital. And so all of the dead and the wounded had to go to the only remaining medical clinic, which was an OBGYN and geriatric center with only 20 beds in the center of town. And Dr. Samir Holmes, who was the chief doctor, told me that he was performing emergency amputations on the floor, that he was performing operations in dental chairs. One of his nurses came in a body bag with her body bisected, and he had to revive his medical staff when they fainted at the sight of their colleague torn in half by a drone missile. Finally, the carnage became so bad that he had to call in ice cream coolers in which to store the bodies of small children who should have been eating ice cream. So what do you call that? How do we define it? I think we need to reorient our language. And one term that I did use in this book is politicide, which is, I think, you know, a conservative term for what the state of Israel is doing to Palestinian society. It was coined by the Israeli sociologist Brooke Kimmerling, and it simply means the intention to destroy the national identity of a group of people, which means that the intention of the state of Israel is to destroy Palestinians as a national unit and transform them into kind of wandering Arabs and Bedouins who could basically be part of, or refugees who could be part of any other Arab nation, who are no longer Palestinian, and therefore they lose the desire to resist. And we saw that mentality, the mentality of politicide, in the plan that was proposed by Moshe Feiglin, a former deputy speaker of the Knesset, after the war, which is concentrate and exterminate. Take everyone out of the Gaza Strip who refuses to take a loyalty oath to the state of Israel and place them in the Sinai Desert, concentrate them in camps. That's what he said. Concentrate them in camps. And those who resist inside Gaza should be exterminated. That is a plan of politicide that could be tantamount to genocide. But I haven't gone there yet with my, you know, definitions and my language.
Max Blumenthal is an award-winning journalist and best-selling author. I spoke with him on Tuesday evening on stage at the First Congregational Church in Los Angeles in front of a packed audience as part of Uprising's speaker series. Blumenthal's new book is called The 51-Day War, Ruin and Resistance in Gaza. A very special thank you to Justin Lebanowski, Eric Sorensen, and Stephen Vittoria for help with recording this event. And thanks to all who made it possible, including the entire Uprising crew. This is Uprising. Anna Buss is our assistant producer and technical director. Christian Beck is our production coordinator. Kiana Turner is our visual editor and research intern. Federico Garcia is our audio engineer. Special thanks to Jonathan Alexander for technical assistance. Annie Mendoza is our social media coordinator. Subscribe to our YouTube channel at youtube.com/uprisingwithsonali. Our website is uprisingwithsonali.com. Our theme music is by Quetzal. I'm Sonali Kolhatkar, host and executive producer of Uprising. I'll see you next time.